Welcome to our Sunday morning worship service.
People love to follow Jesus up to a point. Even today, just as it was on Palm Sunday, people love to talk about Jesus as Lord, as Savior, as the Son of God for them in their lives, to forgive them of all the terrible stuff they do. That part of Jesus' life we love to follow and talk about. What would Jesus do? But the places that Jesus would call us to follow him into discipleship. The road and palm branches people loved. Crowds from everywhere. But the road to Golgotha, well, you can't even drum up his 12 disciples to follow him there. As we celebrate Palm Sunday, we'll consider the ease of cheerleading for Jesus and the difficulty of following Jesus. Just before we begin this call to worship, I want to remind you that if you are able, downstairs in the west entrance, there are plants, Easter flowers. And so if you are able today to take one to one of our homebound to share church with them, some of them are watching right now for the blessing of the web stream. But if you're able to spread some Easter joy and take a flower or plant to them, please do pick one up down in the west entrance today. Let us join together. And I'll let Pastor Karen, come on up here. Force of habit.
You could have done it. It would have been really
and
okay.
Welcoming. Fair enough, for the call to worship.
The call to worship is up on your screen or in your bulletin. Please join me. Jesus, you come into our hearts and lives humbly, patiently, encouraging us to learn and grow, to embark on journeys of hope and healing. You know how we love to serve you, especially when all seems well and easy. You also know our struggles when you ask us to walk with you in difficult places. Give us fresh eyes today that we may once again see your courage, your faithfulness, and your commitment. Teach us to walk with steady obedience in both joy and trial, trusting that you are always with us, giving us exactly what we need to follow you with boldness and integrity. Amen.
Please be seated.
Palm branches lay at the feet of the King.
I'd like to invite any other children or young people at heart of any age to come on down as we sing Jesus Loves Me, This I Know. Can I get a little spot? Unicorn pants there. Well, good morning, boys and girls. How are we today?
We're good.
Wait a minute. Are we awake? Are you paying attention over on this side? I didn't hear anything. How are we doing today?
Good.
Good? Fantastic. What day is today?
It is Sunday.
It is Palm Sunday, though. You wouldn't know it by looking outside, would you? Palm Sunday. That's right. And so when people in Jesus' time would wave palm branches, they could have waved different kinds of branches like oak trees or sycamores or pine needles. But they were waving a symbol. Palm branches symbolized freedom and victory. So it would be like us setting off fireworks for the 4th of July. For the Hebrew people, a palm branch was saying, God is going to deliver us. We're going to be free again. So when Jesus is coming to town, everybody was excited. So I want you to give me your excited cheer and happy face. Can everybody give me an excited cheer?
Yay!
Let me hear a cheer.
Yay!
Can we say, yay, Jesus, go get him? Can we say that?
Yay, Jesus, go get him!
All right, so every time I do a happy face, I'm going to go, yay, Jesus, go get him. And then we're going to go like this, okay? And then we're going to go like this. And we're going to do an angry face. Let me see your angry face. And I want you to say, traitor!
Traitor!
Crucify him!
Crucify
him! Oh, my gosh, really, guys? Now, wait a minute. What happened from Palm Sunday, where everybody is thinking, yay, freedom, yay, Jesus, go, Jesus. And then on Friday, they said, traitor, crucify him. Whoa, something bad happened, right? People thought, this isn't the kind of king we want. So here's what we're going to do, all right? Happy face, ready? Happy face, ready? Yay, go get him, yay, Jesus, all right, freedom. Boo, traitor. Crucify him.
Crucify him.
Yeah. The tide turned very quickly for Jesus in Holy Week to where people who were one time parading and saying, yes, this is the king who is going to deliver us. Hallelujah. He's going to save us. Hosanna, which means God save us. God get us free from these Romans. God lift our country up. God make us powerful and strong again. Hello. To disappointment. This man isn't going to deliver us from the Romans. This man isn't going to do all the fun stuff we thought. He's not going to make us a powerful nation. He's talking about things like love and kindness and showing grace to your enemies. And that made people upset. It turned their cheers into angry jeers and insults. It shouldn't have. It shouldn't have, should it? You're right, Michaela. It shouldn't have. But it did. The very people who paraded on Palm Sunday and said, yes, Jesus, were a lot of the people who also said, we don't know this man. We're not his followers. And so the week ended a little bit sad on Good Friday, yes. But then what happens after Good Friday, after all the people follow him? And after they kill him, and it's very sad, and all the disciples are very sad, then what happens?
And then he comes back alive.
And Jesus comes back to life, and it's Easter Sunday. And everybody who is so sad and disappointed and upset, all of a sudden, everybody's sadness is turned to joy, and they say, oh my goodness, Jesus is alive. Jesus is God's love shown to us. So it's pretty awesome. So boys and girls, I know a lot of people do a lot of crazy crafts with these, like crosses, and somebody made a really intricate thing. So I'm going to do something for you right now. Ready? Prepare to be mystified.
Oh, really?
All right. Can you imagine it? No, this is a fishing rod. See?
Not?
Hold on.
What?
Yeah. This is, here. Yeah. Now use your imagination. Okay. You guys can probably do a little bit better with yours. Okay? Pastor Scott's not very crafty, but you can do something great with your palm branches, but don't use them as a sword, okay, please. All right, let's pray together, and then I'll talk to you in a second, Ken. Let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, boys and girls, yes.
Please join me in the second verse of Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me still today, walking with me on my way, wanting as a friend to give light and love to all who live. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Today's reading comes from Luke chapter 19, verses 28 through 40. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tie there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road.
As he was now approaching the path down from Mount Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory to in the highest of heavens." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out."
We anticipate a riot. This common crowd is much too loud. Tell the mob who sings your song that they are fools and they are wrong. They are accursed. They should disperse.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. God of love and truth, we thank you for gathering us in your house today, for giving us the opportunity to glorify you as we imagine that first Palm Sunday. But Lord, we also know that that celebration of joy and love and excitement, it quickly turned to hate and heckling. And as we celebrate your incredible gift of Jesus, Lord, help us not to turn our faces away, but rather to look head on and to let Jesus set a new direction for us. We want to follow unafraid. We want to answer your call to us and go where you would have us go. But, oh goodness, Lord, we need your strength. We need your courage and your faithfulness and your commitment. Because it is so hard sometimes to withstand the lure of the culture, of the world, instead of standing strong in your vision and your values. So stay close to us this Holy Week. Keep showing us the way. And open us so that we can see the way and not be blinded by our expectations of the kind of God you should be, but rather learn about the kind of God that you are and follow that. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. So as we have said repeatedly already, today marks the beginning of that emotional roller coaster that we call Holy Week. It begins with an incredible and magnificent celebration as Jesus makes his triumphal entry into Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover. And then it takes us through the depths of tragedy as he is betrayed after the Last Supper, arrested and crucified. And then it brings us to that soaring climax of Easter morning and the resurrection. Palms and passion are two words we most often use to describe this day. Palms tell the story of anticipation and promise, the excitement of a coming new king and the freedom that that would bring. They tell of the hopes and dreams of the disciples and the crowd who had walked with Jesus, those who had seen his deeds of power, his compassion, and his love for others. Their confidence had grown to new heights. A new time was at hand. At least that's what they thought. But Jesus' following had grown steadily in numbers and excitement as it led up to this day. And he rode in the town on the back of a donkey into that city of Jerusalem, that city of hope, that city where all their religious beliefs stood and was present. People were gathered around. The excitement grew. They began to throw their cloaks on the ground and taking those fronds of whatever it may have been and shouting, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." It kind of reminds you of the heavenly host when Jesus was born, doesn't it? And for certain, that same sense of hope and expectation did fill the air. A new king had come. Life was finally going to be different. They could feel it in their bones. And yet we know that that celebration was short-lived, that the crowd would soon turn and everything would come to a crashing halt, that this new king that they were so much embracing was about to die. And so this day is also about Jesus' passion. You see, passion tells the story of the cross, of his suffering, and a message that somehow wasn't fully heard or understood during his earthly ministry, despite his popularity. Why did the masses turn against him so quickly, do you think? How did those shouts of Hosanna on Sunday turn to crucify him on Friday? From Sunday to Thursday, Jesus was unstoppable. He had had a meltdown in the temple, exposing its corruption and its abuses, calling it a den of robbers when it was supposed to be a house of prayer. He had wept over Jerusalem and the unwillingness of so many to listen to him and their failure to recognize the gift of peace that he was bringing to them. He fielded questions day after day in the temple about taxes, about resurrection, about the origins of his authority. As the religious leaders repeatedly challenged him, and each time he turned their questions back around, exposing them to their own deceitfulness and their lack of understanding and faithfulness. He gave us the great commandment of love and our most sacred meal, communion. And then it all fell apart. Palms became passion. Cheers turned to jeers. The celebration was replaced by a crucifixion. What was it that changed? It has to be more than Jesus' betrayal or the phenomenon of mob hysteria. What were the deeper causes, those underlying issues that are not so easily seen? What is it that makes a crowd that was so devoted turn so quickly to hate? Was it because of the forces of power that they had once again taken over and the people felt unable to confront or withstand them? Was it because Jesus really didn't meet their expectations? I mean, they wanted and expected a warrior king, a knight in shining armor who would save them from Roman oppression and occupation once and for all. But Jesus simply wasn't that kind of king, and he had shown them that repeatedly over his ministry. But their desires and their expectations had blinded them from seeing it. When he rode into Jerusalem, he came on a donkey, not a war horse. He came silently, not jubilantly. He came in humility, not pompously. And he came offering an invitation to love and to peace, not with a declaration of war. Maybe it was a combination of these things. But I'd like to consider one more possibility this morning. What if it was because Jesus upped the ante? What if it was because he began to talk about taking up a cross that looms high as we approach Holy Week? Up to this point, Jesus had befriended them, cared for them, fed them, healed them, forgiven them. But now he was starting to challenge them. Love one another as I have loved you, he said. For that way people will know that you are my disciples, my followers. Use your talents and your abilities for the work of God, he said, not just for your own personal needs and gain. Put away that sword, he said. Because if you live by the sword, you're gonna die by the sword. If you wanna be great or successful, then you have to become a servant first. If you wanna inherit the kingdom of God, he told the rich young ruler, then you have to go and sell your possessions. Then come and follow me. Let go of your attachments, he said. Give like the poor widow does when she comes to the offering plate. Jesus was pushing. He began to urge the people to move from listening to action, from miracles to life-changing commitment, from forgiveness to real, unadulterated faithfulness. At the very moment when change seemed possible to the people because of what Jesus was doing, It suddenly felt very risky because of what Jesus was asking them to do. And isn't that what happens when we face a challenge that could change the course of our lives? Don't we get just a little bit squirrely? Because as we look out at the unknown, we don't know what to expect. We know what our life is like now. It's familiar, it's comfortable, even if we are not satisfied with some parts of it. But we don't know what it will be like or where we might have to go if we truly take the Jesus challenge. We don't know what will happen if we really start loving everyone. We don't know what will happen if we really lay down our weapons. We don't know what will happen if we really start giving God 10%, 10% of our time, 10% of our talent, and yes, 10% of our treasure. When we first find Jesus, it's kind of like Palm Sunday. It's exciting and exuberant. We feel special and cared for, loved and nourished. But when we are asked to really live like Jesus, with commitment and integrity, or to tend to our spiritual lives with as much vigor as we tend to our secular ones, well, then our cheering begins to get a little quieter. The demands are just a bit too great. And like the crowds in Jerusalem, we flee the streets, we close the doors, and our hosannas get lost in the midst of our fear, in our possessions, and in our desires. It's tempting to bask in the reverie of Palm Sunday and to keep Jesus right there. After all, we do prefer that sweet taste of success and the exhilaration of accomplishment and the pleasures of what all of our resources can bring for us. Palm Sunday feels good. We'd like to stay there. The trouble is, it's not reality. Life is not confined to mountaintop experiences. The valleys, they always await. And therein lies the bitterness of Good Friday. That's where we face the pain of our failures, the frustration of our shoulda, woulda, couldas, the loneliness of loss or rejection, the despair and disappointment of unrealized dreams. We don't like to go there because it's hard and it's uncomfortable and it's disappointing and it's scary. And yet, it is in these very places where we learn what we are made of and where we begin to develop a more enduring faith. That is the journey of Holy Week. The question that we have to answer this morning is, will we take it? Will we walk with Jesus with the same faithfulness and love that he walks with us? Will we embrace his cross as an example so that we can take up ours? The invitation and the challenge of Holy Week is to pay attention. And I invite you, as this week unfolds, to watch carefully. Watch carefully the night of his betrayal, that last night with his disciples, as he greets them with a towel and a basin and lovingly washes every single one of their feet. That's what service and humility look like. Watch carefully when he is arrested, how he is tortured, the way his trial unfolds. Watch the way he stood up for what he believed with peace and courage and integrity, no matter how many insults or ridicule were thrown his way or how much pain he had to endure. That's what faithfulness, commitment, and courage look like. And then watch carefully as he allows himself to be nailed to a cross, out of love for you and for me. That's generosity. That's forgiveness and sacrifice. Holy Week teaches us what it means to be a servant, what it looks like to really live nonviolently and sacrificially. And by that, I mean to surrender to the ways of God, regardless of the personal cost. It teaches us to really love God with all our hearts and souls and mind and strength, and to put God first in our lives. That's what Jesus did. And that's what we are meant to follow. He knew very well what was in store for him when he loaded up on that donkey and made that entry into Jerusalem. And yet he came anyway. He knew very well that when the people were shouting and praising him, that it would soon change to heckling and hate. And yet he came anyway. As we look over our lives this week, we need to ask ourselves, where is my Jerusalem? What is it that has power over me that keeps me from moving forward? What in my life needs to be sacrificed or reprioritized or let go of? What do I need to confront so that I can stand firm in the ways of God rather than succumbing to the ways of the world? Am I willing to take this trip? It's very tempting to leap from Palm Sunday straight over to Easter, from glory to glory. But we all know that's not how life works. Life is both joy and sorrow. But what saves us in those times of sorrow and suffering is our commitment to press forward, just like Jesus did, knowing and trusting that God's love will bring us to Easter morning. These are dark days, yes, but it is in the dark days that we do our best growing, because that's when we discover again the very essence of the one who was willing to lay down his life for you and for me. That's where we become reacquainted with faithfulness and forgiveness and grace and commitment and courage. And we are assured once again that despite our pain, despite our failures, despite our shortcoming, there is a light in the world that darkness cannot overcome. And that Easter Sunday always, always follows Good Friday. God bless you. Amen.
As the 12 and the women who followed Jesus probably knew, it was easy to follow when everybody was awed by the healing that Jesus did and great crowds are gathering around and you're imagining, we're going to sit on 12 thrones when you come into your glory. All those things are easy and nice to think about. But as Pastor Cameron said, what about when it costs us something beyond popularity, beyond acceptance? When Jesus calls us to stand for and to do things that are difficult, that go against the grain of culture or go against the grain of things that people around us are doing, that's when the cross comes into play. And many of us are found wanting to avoid it altogether, to deny or to sell out for whatever price we may have. As we prepare in our time of prayer, I invite you to look at those who are named on page 5, begin thinking of the Walczak family, particularly the Clintworth family and Kierkegaard families. So we say an earthly goodbye to both of them. And let us take a moment of silent prayer and then we will pray together. Let us pray. Lord, as you ride in from the Mount of Olives into the East Gate, the place that all the prophets said the Messiah would come in to deliver a new Jerusalem, a new kingdom born of heaven that would shake the earth. That's no wonder crowds came out to see what was up, shaking their victory branches and eagerly anticipating the Romans running back to the places they came from and cowering fear, for a new king was about to make his way to his throne. And while you did have your eyes set on a kingdom, the way you went about achieving it was stunning, disappointing to many, confusing, baffling. What do you mean we're not going to war? What do you mean we're not going to take power away from those who already have it? What do you mean the poor and the weak and meek are blessed? What kind of kingdom is this anyway? What is it you're asking me to do, Jesus? Where is it that you'd have me to go and to stand with you? I will admit, like the others, when the rubber hits the road and they are coming to arrest you, my first instinct is to run for my life too. When they sentence you to die, my instinct is to hide in the shadows of the courtyard as well. When people ask, "Do you know him?" and it might cost me something to live in the truth, I'm quick to say, "I've never met you." And that you rise again and offer us peace. After all our failures and disappointments, you invite us to come, continue to be part of something born of God that can only come from you. Again, we say, what kind of kingdom is this that you would continue to invite us to it? Help us this Easter week to live fully into the blessing of what it means to be your followers, not just believers, but those who would follow you wherever you would take us, with courage, with great joy, with conviction, and most of all, grounded in the love you have for all your creation. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we offer ourselves this week, there are many different ways that we offer our gifts, some of them in the plates Sunday morning to support the ministries that we do together in our community as a church, some of them well beyond these walls. And so as you're thinking about the offering today, not just shuffling through purses and wallets and checks, but think about, as you go out the doors this Easter week, who it is you might encounter, who will you cross paths with at work or at school or at home, and how you can be Easter joy to them. The church is, as beautiful as it is, not this stuff. The church is here. Let us be the church as we offer ourselves to God this Easter. Amen. Ushers can come forward for the morning offering.
Who is it?
Please rise. God, thank you for the gift of Easter, which redefines who we are and the way we see the world. Help us to give everything we got, our voices, our song, our bodies, our minds, our resources and time, and our treasures, to building this kingdom in great love, in peace, and in joy. In our Christ, our risen Lord, we pray. Amen. I invite you to remain standing for our closing song, which is number 268, Right On, Right On in Majesty, and 1, 2, and 5 are the verses we'll sing. 1, 2, and 5.
If you are joining us for the first time today or coming back as a frequent visitor, once again, we want to tell you how much we welcome you. And if we can do anything before you, don't forget to put it down there on the friendship pad so that we can minister to you more fully. As part of our tradition here at First Congregational, we would like to join hands at the end of the service for our sung benediction. And that is a symbol that we are in this together, that we are the body of Christ, and that when we leave this place, we take it all out into the world. So join us in the singing of ancient words. So rich. Allow yourself to drink it in as fully as you can. Come to as many services as you can, and if you can't come, at least mark the day. Remember what Maundy Thursday means, what Good Friday is, what Holy Saturday is. And then as an added benefit, find your Bibles this week. Open it up to chapter 19 in Luke, and every night read a chapter as you gather your family for dinner. You'll be done by Easter Sunday, and I promise you, you will not regret it. So now, may you find hope in the midst of despair. May you know assurance when those times of doubt come. And may the light of peace always shine in the midst of turmoil. And wherever your journey takes you, no matter where it can lead you, always know that you are drawing closer to the heart of God. Amen.
Everybody, please stay if you are able. We have something a little different today. Justin and Kelly are going to do a total instrumental postlude song for us.